eyes haven't seen, and ears haven't heard, the kind of blessings, the kind of blessings that's about to fall on me. Victory is here. Kick defeat out the door. God's doing a new thing. Yeah. Get ready for overflow. 'Cause I'm getting ready.
I'm getting ready to see
something I've never seen.
Good morning, good morning. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We are just so glad that you have come by today to join with us here at Cashmere Garden Missionary Baptist Church, located on the north side of Houston, Texas, on this Resurrection Sunday, to come together to worship the name of Jesus. Do I have one or two people that don't mind right now testifying that the Lord has been good to them? I don't know about you, but he woke me up this morning and he started me on my way, gave me a reasonable portion of health and strength. I can testify that I know that it is in him that I live, it is him that I move, and it is him that I have my being. And as the Bible has declared, let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Come on, I know you can praise him right where you are. He's been too good to us to stay silent right now. We ought to lift up our voices and offer up the sweet sacrifice of praise, letting him know that we are grateful for this opportunity to gather and worship his holy name. Look, why don't you come along with us as we lift up Zion songs together, making our minds ready for the word of God. Come on, let's praise the Lord together.
Amen, and praise the Lord, everybody. Good morning, Cashmere, and happy Easter. This is Resurrection Sunday. This is our praise and worship hour. We want you to stand on your feet. Those of you who are viewing, come on, let's exalt the Lord together.
Jesus died for me.
Yes, I'm glad.
I'm glad that Jesus rose for me.
Three long days.
Got up from that grave. He got up, bowed down in his head.
Yeah, I'm glad.
I'm glad that Jesus died for me.
Yes, I'm glad.
I'm glad that Jesus rose for me. He got up,
all
power in his hand.
I'm glad.
I'm glad that Jesus died for me.
I'm so glad.
I'm glad that Jesus rose for me.
Three
long days. Ooh. Got up from that grave. He got up, all power in his hand.
He stayed there.
He stayed there
all day Friday night. He stayed.
He stayed there
all day Saturday. He stayed there
all
day Saturday night. But
got up.
He got up.
He got up.
With all power.
He got up.
With all power.
He got up.
Not black power.
He got up.
Not white power.
He got up.
But all power.
He got up.
He got up.
He got up.
Does anybody know it?
He got up.
Does anybody know it?
He got up.
He got up.
So glad that he got up, because he got up, and he didn't get up any kind of way. He got up with all power in his hand, power over death, power over sin, and power over the grave. For that, we ought to have praise on our lips and glorify our Father in heaven for providing us the precious Lamb of God. Amen. On today, if you would, turn with me in your Bibles to Mark, the 16th chapter. And for our devotional reading, we will read the first 7 verses. Mark 16, verses 1 through 7. And the word of God reads, "When the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome bought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. And they were saying to one another, 'Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?' And looking up, they saw that the stone had been rolled back. It was very large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, dressed in a white robe, and they were alarmed. And he said to them, 'Do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you.'" That was Mark 16, verses 1 through 7, ESV. May God have a blessing on the reading, the hearing, and the doing of his holy word. Let us pray. Lord, we come today before you confessing our sins, knowing, O God, that we have sinned and we have come short of your glory. We know, O God, that it was only by the blood atoning work of Calvary. Heavenly Father, we're able to come to you knowing, O God, you're the only one who hears our prayer and answers our prayer. We come humbly submitting ourselves to your will, asking God now that you create in us a clean heart and renew a right spirit within us. We come, O Heavenly Father, on this morning celebrating the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We pray on today, O God, for those that are lost, who do not know Jesus in the pardon of their sin. We pray, O God, that there is something said or done, that Heavenly Father, that might illuminate their minds and hearts, that they might seek you while you might be found. Praying, O God, today that you make us strongest witnesses in the earth, that we might go forth and carry the gospel message, that all those that hear it might hear it and be converted and live a life that is acceptable in thy sight. On today, oh God, we lift up the bereaved. We lift up those that are sick amongst us. We lift up those, oh Heavenly Father, that are widowed, those that are orphans. God, we pray for even those behind prison walls. We ask it on today, God, that you will continue to let your mercy go forth. We know, oh God, that mercy seats all of our case. So, Lord, we thank you even on today for being compassionate towards us. And we ask, oh God, that you bless us like only you can. Pray on today, God, for this service. We pray now for those that will sing Zion songs. We pray for the preached word. Pray, oh God, for the listener. We pray for the heart. That Heavenly Father, that as the word go forth, it is a seed planted on good ground, that in due season it might produce fruit. Lord, we ask on today that you just have thine own way in this service. That Heavenly Father, all that we do glorify you. And we're going to be so careful to give you and you alone the praise. In Jesus' name we do pray, and we all said amen. Amen, amen. As we go a little high in service, we want you to come along and worship the Lord in spirit and truth, for he is truly worthy to be praised.
Well, praise the Lord. Good morning, and praise the Lord on this Resurrection Sunday. To our Kashmir Gardens family, it's an honor and a privilege to be with you. I just want to say one thing, that because he got up, you can get up too, out of every situation that is holding you down. Today, we just want you to know that we are grateful, and that the cross he did not have to do, but how many glad that he did? Yes. Hallelujah. Woo! Listen. I'm so grateful that you love me. I'm so grateful that you care. The cross, you did not have to do it, but I'm thankful that you did. Say it with me.
I'm so grateful that you love me.
Oh yeah, I'm
so grateful that you care.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
Cross, you did not have to do it.
You didn't have to do it, but you did, and I'm thankful.
Yeah. That you did.
Oh,
I'm
so grateful that you love me. Oh yeah, I'm
so grateful that you care.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah, the cross you did not, you didn't have to do it, but you did, and I'm thankful,
and I'm thankful.
I gotta say it again. I am
grateful.
I need my grateful people.
Grateful.
Get your hands in the air, lift your voice and declare,
grateful.
Yeah,
I am grateful.
I am
grateful.
I am
grateful.
Oh yeah.
So
oh, I am so grateful that you love me. Yeah. I'm so grateful that you care. The cross, you did not have to do it. Well, but I'm thankful that you dare. Can you say with me?
I'm so grateful that you love
if
me.
You agree, if you agree, yeah.
I'm so grateful that you care.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. The cross you did not
have to do.
You didn't have to do it, but you did, and I'm thankful.
And I'm thankful that you did.
And I realize that the cross you did not have to do. Yeah, yeah.
And I'm thankful that you did.
We getting better take it and run it back. We want you to lift this up in your spirit. Come on. Help me say I'm
grateful.
I'm grateful.
So grateful.
Oh, yes, I am.
Grateful.
I'm grateful.
So grateful.
So grateful.
I am grateful.
You went to the
so
cross.
Grateful.
So I wouldn't be lost.
I am grateful.
You hung on a tree.
So
just to make me free.
Oh,
I said, oh, the blood.
Oh,
they pierced you in the side. The blood came streaming down.
I'm happy.
I'm happy.
Grateful.
appreciate.
Oh my, I'm happy.
I'm happy.
Happy. I'm grateful.
Grateful. Appreciate.
Yeah.
I'm happy.
Yeah.
Grateful.
Listen.
Appreciate.
You've been so faithful.
I'm happy.
That's why I'm so grateful.
Grateful.
Listen. They hung you high.
I'm happy.
Stretched him wide.
Appreciate.
He hung his head.
I'm happy.
And for me.
Grateful.
And for me.
Appreciate.
For me he died.
I'm happy.
Yeah. Gallop with all power in his hand. Yeah.
Grateful. Appreciate.
I'm so grateful you love me. Love me. Love me. The cross you did not have to do. Oh, but I'm mighty, 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 mighty grateful that you did.
The cross you did not have to do.
You didn't have to do it, but you did. And I'm thankful.
But I'm thankful that you did.
Whoa, yeah. Come on, if you're grateful, give him praise right where you are. In the car, in your living room, in the kitchen. If you're grateful, give him glory. I remember this song growing up as a child. It just says, at the cross, where I first saw the light, burdens of my heart, they rolled away. It was there, by faith, I received it. I receive my sight, and now I am happy. Oh, I'm happy, grateful, appreciate you. You say it.
I'm happy, woo! Grateful, appreciate.
When I look back over my life,
I'm happy,
yeah.
Grateful, appreciate.
Think about how you saved me, raised me, healed me, feel me. Yeah, I am grateful.
I'm happy.
Yeah.
Grateful, appreciate.
Oh, I'm happy.
I'm happy.
Yeah.
Grateful, appreciate.
One last time. The cross you did not have to do. But I'm thankful that you did. There's another song that I'm grateful for Hezekiah Walker for writing. And sometimes you got to just thank God for the sacrifice. The old people used to say he was hung up for our hang-ups. And I'm grateful that God took my place on the cross. Come on, if you're grateful that he took your place, just lift that hand right where you are. Hallelujah. Come on, just lift up some sweet words of worship wherever you are. Oh, my, 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 my. Yeah. Oh, oh yeah. Mm-hmm. Listen. I am grateful for the things that you have done. Yes, I'm grateful for the victories we've won. I could go on and on and on, on and on and on and on and on about your work. Because I'm grateful, I'm really grateful, and I praise you, Lord. Flowing from my heart are the issues of my heart. What are they? Yes, gratefulness. Oh, my. I gotta go to the vamp of this song right here. Oh, I am grateful.
Grateful, grateful,
just think about it for a minute.
Grateful, grateful,
He's been real good. Oh,
grateful.
Can you say flowing? Oh, yeah. You've been faithful. And I'm so grateful. Oh, Lord. They put nails in your hand. They put nails in your feet. Yeah, yeah. Lift up your worship to him. Tell him, are the issues of my heart? Tell him again. Flowing, flowing, flowing.
Flowing from
my heart. One last time, one last time.
Are the issues
of my heart? Gratefulness. If you're really grateful, if you're really thankful, come on, lift your voice and give him glory. Come on, lift your voice and give him glory. Come on, lift your voice and give him glory. Come on, lift your voice and give him glory. He's worthy. He's worthy. Oh, yes, he is.
How many of you are grateful for all that God has done? When you look back over your life and think about how God has brought you through, is there anybody who's grateful for what God has done? I don't know about you, but I'm glad to know that God never left me. He never forsook me. He stayed right there with me through the ups and downs of my life, and I'm truly grateful for all that he has done. But no greater thing that he did than when he gave us Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, as the blood atoning work of Calvary was performed, the propitiation of our sin was rendered by one person, that man being Jesus Christ, our Lord. It is there that on today we celebrate this Resurrection Sunday, the goodness of the Lord extended towards mankind. Amen. I pray today that you've been blessed by the song service. And if you would today, turn with me in your Bibles to Mark, the 16th chapter. And for your hearing consideration, verses 9 through 14. Mark, the 16th chapter, verses 9 through 14. I'll be reading from the English Standard Version. And the Word of God reads as follows. Now, when he rose early on the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, from whom he had cast out seven demons. She went and told those who had been with him, as they mourned and wept. But when they heard that he was alive and had been seen by her, they would not believe it. After these things, he appeared in another form to two of them as they were walking into the country. And they went back and told the rest, but they did not believe them. Afterward, He appeared to the 11 themselves as they were reclining at table, and he rebuked them for their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they had not believed those who saw him after he had risen. On this morning, I would like to speak from these three words in the form of a question. Do you believe? Do you believe? As we have studied this book of Mark over the last year, we have journeyed with Jesus, watching Jesus in action. We've seen Jesus baptized. We've watched him tempted in the wilderness by Satan. We've watched him choose 12 disciples. We watched him do miracle after miracle. Not only that, we've heard him teaching in the synagogues. And because of this, Jesus himself was popular on one end, but he was hated on another. The people, they thronged around him. They formed multitudes as he would preach, as he would teach, and as he would perform miracle after miracle. But that was a group of religious leaders who feared that because of Jesus' message and his miracles, that he would take away from what they had going on with the temple's business. Jesus, as we've learned recently, had great disdain for what was going on in the temple. For even before he was arrested, he cleansed the temple and let them know that his Father's house should be called a house of prayer, and that they had turned it into a den of thieves. Even on the night of the Passover, the Last Supper, as we refer to it, when he took and had the last Passover with his disciples, he teaches them a lesson on humility as he washes their feet, because there was a great argument amongst them of who would be the greatest among them. Jesus, girding himself, washes their feet to teach them that the greatest among you must be the servant of all. Jesus then leaves out of that meal, knowing that he would be betrayed by Judas Iscariot, goes to the Garden of Gethsemane, where he agonizes in prayer, realizing that the hour has come that he would lay down his life according to the will of the Father. It is at this moment he agonizes in prayer over the separation that would occur in that moment, realizing that he would take on the sins of the world, and it would be at that very instance that he would be separated from his Father for the first time in eternity. I don't know about you, but that was enough to make Jesus sweat as though there were drips of blood coming from his body. Jesus then, recognizing that the hour was upon him, knowing now that he would be turned over into the hands of sinful men, he endured the beatings. He endured the crucifixion. And now he was laid in a borrowed tomb by Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus. Laid there on Friday night, laid there all day Saturday. And on today, we see that there are a chain of events that happen up to the moments leading to our text. What happens next is that on that day, several women come to the tomb early in the morning with the necessary spices and ointments in order to put the embalming spices on his body, which was custom at that time. They come to discover that an angel had rolled away the stone from the tomb. Not only that, the guards that were posted at the tomb have panicked and they have fled. When the women arrive, after much concern about who would roll the stone away, they found the tomb, the stone rolled away, and the contents empty of the body of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Two angels appear to these women inside the tomb, and tell the women that Jesus is alive and that they should go and tell the disciples. The women go to tell the disciples, but they don't believe their report. As a matter of fact, Peter and John run to the tomb and also found it empty and returned home. But later on, Mary Magdalene comes back to the tomb. She remains there alone and she's crying. And then she sees an angel. And then she sees the risen Savior. That's where we find ourselves on this morning. Mary herself alone at the tomb has now witnessed the risen Savior for herself. One would think, as we read in the text, that Mark tells us that he appeared first to Mary Magdalene. Of all of the people that Jesus could have revealed himself to on that blessed morning, he chose to reveal himself first to Mary Magdalene. Most of us, if it was us, would have revealed ourselves perhaps to our mother or our father, but he chose Mary Magdalene because, first of all, Mary Magdalene was at the grave. She was there all alone. She was prepared to continue to minister to Jesus, realizing that it was Jesus who had changed her life, who had set her on a road called straight. Mark 9 reminds us of who and what kind of woman Mary was when she met Jesus. He tells us that Jesus had cast 7 demons out of Mary when he met her. So essentially, when Jesus met her, she was demon possessed. She was trapped in the worst kind of bondage. She was in the grip of Satan. She was living a life that was wicked and giving herself over to every kind of sin and vice imaginable. And it is because we see Mary, who once was demon possessed, here weeping at the grave of Jesus. It reminds us, when we look at ourselves, that all of us was something before we met Jesus. We all were born in sin and shapen in iniquity. We were all without strength, but then Christ dies for the ungodly. As a matter of fact, if you think back over your life and some of the actions and some of the thoughts and some of the ways in which you've lived, you can recognize that it was only God's amazing grace that permitted you this opportunity to be where you are today. And just like Mary, who's sitting at the tomb wondering where our Lord is, she's there out of concern for where his body has gone. Matter of fact, when you think about it, it's when she met Jesus that everything became brand new. From that moment that he spoke to her and delivered her from those 7 demons, she instantly began to follow him. As a matter of fact, it's recorded in Luke 8:1-3, that she was one of the women who was with Jesus, who had been healed of evil spirits and infirmities, which ministered to Jesus of their substance. That let me know that she didn't just go around with a bunch of hallelujahs and a bunch of amens, but she was there to commit herself wholly to the service in the ministry of Jesus Christ, our Lord. And she took her own substance and gave to him that whatever it is that he needed along the way, she and other women were there to provide it. That ought to be good news to all of us on today, that no matter what you once was, that God has given you a new chance, that whatever God has permitted and allowed for you to have by way of stewardship, you ought to not keep anything back from the Lord. You ought to be willing to commit yourself wholly to him, not only in your worship and in your praise with your lips, but also with your substance. Because she loved Jesus and she honored him, he honored her love for him by allowing her to be the first to see him as the risen from the dead. Matter of fact, when you think about it, those who have been forgiven the most seem to love him the most. In the book of Luke, chapter 7, verses 36 through 50, it talks about a Pharisee who invites Jesus over to eat. And while he's there, there's a sinful woman who approaches him with an alabaster box, who pours this expensive perfume over him and begins to wipe his feet with her hair and her tears. And he himself, the Pharisee, thought if this man were really a prophet, he would know what kind of woman is touching him, for she is a sinner. The truth is, he then tells this story. He says, well, there was a man who had two people who owed him a debt. One owed him 500 pieces and another owed him 50. But he forgave them both. The question is, who do you think loved him the most or appreciated the forgiving of the debt the most? And the answer is the one who had the biggest debt. The whole remedy to that is, when God has delivered you out of the penalty of death, sin, and the grave, and you've lived a life of torment, when God changes your life, the appreciation that you have, the gratitude that you feel, makes you commit yourself, that gives you that sense of conviction of your faith, to know that no matter what is going on, that you're going to stay with the Lord. I believe Paul would testify to this fact, knowing that he was a persecutor of the Christian, that on that Damascus road that he encountered Jesus, and Jesus simply asked him, why do you persecute me? This would be the same Paul who, after being blinded 3 days, would go on to be one who writes most of the New Testament. But he pins these words that says, I have learned in whatever state that I find myself in to be content. He's learned how to be abased and abound. When God has touched you and you realize all that you have been through, you would have an attitude like Mary, who committed herself to following our Lord, even to the cross, even to the tomb, and now there to minister to him after he has been placed in the borrowed tomb. Let me let you know that there are some of you today who have plumbed deep in the depths of sin, and God found you right where you were. He changed your life dramatically, and now you love him for all that he has done for you. This love itself will manifest in ways that are sometimes different from those which weren't in such a wicked condition. The Lord appears to Mary to console her broken heart. It was his ministry of love and grace on his part that helped a hurting and wounded believer through the time of heartache. And as he confirms and reaffirms her, letting her know that I'm alive, just as I promised, he says, now I need you to go and tell the other disciples. The Bible says when she went and told those that had been with him, as they mourned and wept, she goes and tell them, and they were in there, they were in a time of sorrow, thinking that I have good news, I have something that will help you get over this time of mourning and weeping. I know that he's alive. I've seen him for myself. I've talked to him for myself. As a matter of fact, he wants us to meet him in Galilee. He says that he will go before us to Galilee. And in spite of her report, they did not believe her. Truth is, in that day and time, the testimony of a woman was of no legal value in the ancient Jewish society. As a matter of fact, had this been just a made up or invented story by one of the early church writers, he would not have emphasized Mary's witness to the narrative. He would not have introduced her as a witness to the Lord's being arisen. But look at what happens. God pins this right here for us to know that God's ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. As a matter of fact, their unbelief did not change her experience. She had still seen the risen Lord, and there was nothing that could change that. Listen, I want to tell somebody today that finds themselves in the shoes of Mary Magdalene, listen, you don't let anyone steal your joy. There may be some people that are around you who are satisfied and silent on the sidelines. There may be some who are comfortable in their complacency. However, you know what he did for you. You know about his touch. You know about his power. You know about his forgiving hand. You know about his love. And you ought to rejoice in what he has done for you. And don't let anybody dull and mundane religious exercise drain your fresh, new spiritual life out of you. You ought to commit yourself to stand in your convictions, recognizing that your testimony is true, and regardless of who hears it and believes it, you stand on the word, knowing that it was God and God alone who brought you through. You would think that those who had already been privy to being with Jesus, those that had traveled with Jesus, those that had bad witness to all that he had done, that these would have been excited because they should have remembered the word of Jesus when he told them that he would see them again after the crucifixion. But because of it, maybe because they looked at Mary's reputation and said, how we gonna listen to her? Maybe because she was one person that they needed someone else to confirm that they saw him too. Maybe it was because she was a woman. No, nobody really knows, but what the scripture says is they didn't believe her. Next, the text says that after these things, he appeared in another form to two of them. Well, surely now that he's appearing to more than one, for the law required that there be a witness established between two or three. Perhaps that after he is there with these two, that they can bear witness that those that hear might believe. But sadly, the Bible records that they didn't believe them either. This story is told in Luke, known as the two that were traveling on the road of Emmaus. They were sad, their countenance was low, because they thought that Jesus would come and set up a kingdom on earth, that now they see that Jesus has been dead. And truly at this point, there was no point to continue on. They left Jerusalem heading some 7 miles outside of the city. But along the way of going away from Jerusalem, that name Jerusalem meaning the place of peace, they ran across one that they had never seen before. Bible says that he appeared to them in another form. And as they were walking, he began to talk to them regarding the scripture. And he was getting ready to go one way, but they compelled him to stay with them. And when it was time to eat, he took bread. And when he had broken it and given thanks and given it to them, it is there that they recognized who Jesus was. But the Bible says he then disappeared from their sight. And they had these words to say, didn't our hearts burn as he opened up the scriptures to us? You would think that after that they encountered him, it says that now they go back to tell the rest, but they didn't believe them either. Listen, even though those two were on their way away from the place that he told them to be, once they heard the word of God, once they came in contact with Jesus, who is a heart fixer and a mind regulator. It renewed their thinking. It changed their mind and heart, and it gave them a spirit of evangelism and their countenance, which was sad when they started their trip. He turned their crying into rejoicing, and they turn and they go and share the good news with the others, but they didn't believe them either. The question is today, how much more would Jesus have to do in order for them that walked with him, those that witnessed those that things that he did, how much more would he have to do to prove that he had resurrected from the dead? He then shows up to the 11 themselves as they are now eating together, and he rebukes them for their unbelief and hardness of heart because they had not believed those who saw him after he was risen. Now, those are two issues that we have even today as Christians today: unbelief and hardness of heart. The question comes, what causes this unbelief? What causes the hardness of heart? What causes the heart to grow hard usually is disappointment. The disappointment in others, being unwilling to trust or risk loving another or risk doing for another because they won't reciprocate that which you've given them. Jesus demonstrates and lets us know that because of relationships in the Old Testament, Moses had to make a law concerning divorce because of the hardened hearts of the men. Hardened hearts can develop in relationships, and it's hardened hearts that lead to fractures or separation. And even in the scripture, we can see this Mary, who was with them following Jesus. They knew who she was, that they knew that she had ministered to him. And when she came and gave the report, they wouldn't believe. The two disciples who knew them as well came back and let them know that they had been in contact with Jesus and that he was risen. They didn't respond well. They did not believe their report either. Listen, that's what happens in church a lot of times when people come testifying on what God has done in their life, how God has stepped in and intervened on their behalf, because we haven't experienced it for ourselves, because we have not experienced him healing our body. We haven't experienced him coming in and stepping in when we needed financial help, when we needed to get our minds settled because we was almost on the verge of giving up, almost on the verge of losing our mind, and he grabbed the reins of our mind. And when you realize that it was God and God alone, it gives you the conviction of your faith to be able to tell anybody that Jesus Christ lives, and he lives today. I don't know about you, you can proclaim words like, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. But that is the residue. That is what happens when God has touched you through Jesus Christ and allowed you to see his hand of grace and mercy on your life. I want to tell somebody that even though you know it to be true, there are going to be some who just not going to believe. Because of these hardness of their heart, they were not only disappointed in others, but seem as if they were disappointed in God himself, because things did not turn out the way they wanted them to. Listen, I remember the Israelites wandering in the wilderness had hard hearts because they had ran out of water, and because they had difficult times. Psalm 95:8 tells us they developed hard hearts and they complained against God. For these disciples, they had just gone through the biggest disappointment ever. They had expected Jesus to become king and to take over the world. They had trusted him. They had left everything that they had. And he ends up letting them down because he died. Not just that he died, it's almost like he wanted to die. He didn't even resist the cross. This caused much disappointment. It caused hardness of heart. And let me let you know, many of us, hearts have been hardened because of the disappointments in our lives. We want to know, well, why is it that God did not keep our mother or father alive? Why he let my child die? Why did he let me lose my job? Why did I have to go through this divorce? Why is it that my body is full of sickness and pain? Why is it that I live how I live, where I live, with whom I live? Why is it that God has allowed me to suffer so much? I'm disappointed in what God has done in my life, and it causes the hardening of your heart. When your heart is hard, when your mind is not regulated, you begin to take a fleshly understanding. You start to try to think with logic. You try to rationalize yourself through your situation. You try to have self-help. You try to figure out a way to solve the problem on your own. But the truth is, things are getting worse and worse. Come here, woman with the issue of blood. When she had given and paid all she could, going from physician to physician, finally she came across the great physician, and at the touch of the hem of his garment, she was made whole. All I'm saying is, you can do all you can do, but there is never any failure in Jesus Christ. These disciples had experienced disappointment because of their fleshly mind wanting Jesus to have an earthly kingdom, but the kingdom that Jesus had was a spiritual kingdom. God himself institutes a new covenant, and this new covenant is built in love of a soft heart, of a mind that understands forgiveness, grace and mercy, long suffering, patience and gentleness and kindness. The Old Testament, the law was full of rules. It was a taskmaster by which no man could stand under. But Jesus came and he lived perfectly before God, thereby being the perfect sacrifice, able to give his life. And that blood that was shed was acceptable because he was a perfect man dying for a sinful man. And I'm so glad today to report that in spite of their hardened heart, Jesus himself never left them. He never forsook them. He just rebuked them. And let me tell you, he's going to always chastise those that he loves. So somebody is going through some issues and some situations, but the truth is, when you really think about it, he still woke you up this morning. He still started you on your way. You still have a reasonable portion of health and strength. As a matter of fact, you can look back over your life and you can see where God has brought you from. As a matter of fact, the truth is, you don't deserve anything that you've received, but it is only by his grace and his mercy that you're able to be that you are. It is this hardening of heart, this unbelief. Unbelief is an enemy of the people of God. God wants us to have faith. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. It is the evidence of things not seen. He's not telling us to just have faith to have faith. He's saying have faith in God. You ought to be able to trust that God himself is loving enough, that he's merciful enough, that he won't put more on you than you can bear. And in spite of the fact that they were there reclining and eating, he himself was upset with them because there were witnesses that had come to give them encouragement in the journey and to let them know that he was risen. But they were taking time to sit down and commune and have fellowship, and in their hearts they were hardened, and in their minds they had unbelief. Let me let you know today that it is faith that helps produce our works. It is what keeps the Christian going. What Jesus knew is that they were going to experience some difficult times ahead in ministry. That there were going to be some hard days ahead. And they were going to have to face unbelievable persecution. And they were going to have to go through many things that would indicate that they should quit and just walk away. but they just needed to keep on going. They would need to keep telling people about Jesus, and that would require faith, trusting Jesus despite their circumstances and telling them just who Jesus was. I don't know about you, but I'm glad today that the Hebrew writer took time in the 11th chapter to begin to let us know that it was by faith that Noah, being divinely warned of things yet not seen, moved with godly fear, prepared an ark for saving of his household, by which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness, which is according to faith. Noah wasn't a perfect man, but he believed God and he began to do the work. He did not see the rain, but if God said that it was gonna rain, Noah just started building the ark. He didn't know how many days it was gonna take. He didn't know about his strength, but he says, if God says do it, I'm gonna have faith in God and do it. And it was counted unto him as righteousness. Abraham, when he obeyed and he left his family, he left for the promised land that God had promised him. In spite of the fact that he didn't even know where the promised land was, he didn't have friends come back from Canaan to tell him that that was good land there, good land for sale. God directed him on where to go. He went following God, not knowing where God was leading him. But he took one step and he took another step and kept walking until God got him into the place that he would have him be. And that's what I want to tell somebody today, that you got to have faith in God in spite of the fact of what you see with your eyes, what you've experienced around you. You got to know that God has already worked out your end, even in the beginning. He is the author and the finisher of our faith. Because of this, Jesus rebukes them and lets them know that they did not believe those that had come and told him, that had seen him after he had risen. I don't know how this is hidden for nobody else, but the question is, do you believe? It's really unbelievable to me that they didn't believe Mary, even though they saw the tomb empty, even though they seen the stone rolled away, even though she came back reported that she seen the risen Savior. It's unbelievable to me that the two disciples would come back and give the report that they had seen Jesus, that they had communed with Jesus, and they still didn't believe him. And now Jesus has to show up as they're having a meal. The other gospels record that it was Thomas who would not believe. And Jesus himself appears and tells him to feel his hands and feel his side so that he could believe. John records, he says, blessed are you who have seen and believe, but bless y'all who haven't seen and yet believe. He understood that they would have to carry a message without any physical evidence of his death, burial, and resurrection, that they would have to speak these words of truth to those who would not have the privilege of living during this time and be able to stand in the conviction of their faith, of the word of God, knowing that what they say is true, and knowing that the word of God is able to be a heart fixer, a mind regulator, that it could change the thinking, it could transform people from the old man to the new man. I don't know about you, but today I would like to report that I believe in everything that he says. I believe that Jesus was born of a virgin's birth. I believe that he dwelled among us, that he acquainted himself with our griefs and with our sorrows. I believe that he loved us enough that he went to Calvary to die for your sins and mine. I believe that they took him down and that they put him in a borrowed tomb. I believe that on the third day morning that he arose with all power in his hand. I believe that he'll never leave me nor forsake me. I believe that he's on the right hand of the Father. I believe that one day he's going to return for me. I believe that I'm going to be with him forever. I believe in just what he says. On today, the question is, do you believe? Has Jesus just become another figure in folklore, like Paul Bunyan, Cinderella, just a story being told? Or is this good news, this gospel message, transforming of your life and the way you live before God and one another? Have you really decided to let your light so shine before men that they might see your good works but glorify your Father which is in heaven? Have you really taken time to make the decision to follow Jesus? Look, he says that if you are not willing to deny yourself, take up your cross and follow him. He says, if you're not willing to love one another, if you're not willing to let go mother, father, sisters, brothers, land, all for the God, he says, you're not even worthy to be my disciples. On today, this question of do you believe, you ought to search your mind and your heart. Don't take this as just a story being told on this Resurrection Sunday to just be cast to the side come Monday. Matter of fact, you ought to wake up, if the Lord allow us, Monday with a whole new perspective of the cross. You ought to be able to see not only the cross but the empty tomb, knowing that that symbolizes that he got up, which means that when you must die, for it's appointed once for every man to die, and after that to judgment. From dust we came, dust we shall return. The good news is that is a resurrection for us, for all of us who believe in Jesus Christ, our Lord. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believe in him shall not perish, but shall have everlasting life. On today, just extending yourself in faith towards what he did on Calvary, you can accept the reconciliation, the redemption of your soul by God himself through his Son. And you can experience being resurrected, being made new, baptized in the blood, washed white as snow. You today, through faith, can experience this transformation. Listen, I'm not telling you it's going to be easy, but I'm going to let you know it's going to be a whole lot better, because you have a blessed hope. You have a confidence in knowing that everything that he has said, he will perform. On today, on this Resurrection Sunday, I pray today that everybody under the sound of my voice believes in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I pray on today that something was said that will remind you of who Jesus is, that it will remind you of what he did on Calvary, but more importantly, what God did on that third day by raising him up. I'm so glad today that Jesus is alive and well, sitting at the right hand of the Father, making intercession for you and I. And on today, we ought to make sure that we're doing all we can to live our life before him, that he might be pleased with our service. On today, I may have someone that don't know Jesus in the pardon of their sin, who trying to figure out, you know, what is this all about? Pastor, you don't know I've done so much of this and so much of that. There's no way that he will forgive me of all of this. Let me let you know, he's already died for it. When he died, he took on all the sins of the world. There's not one sin that was left out or that was omitted. He took them all on. The question is, do you believe enough to have faith enough to trust him at what he says? He says, if you can believe in your heart, confess it with your mouth, that Jesus Christ was resurrected by the power of God, he says, you shall be saved. And that's all it takes today, is for you to say it out your mouth. I believe, God, that you resurrected Jesus Christ from the grave after he died on Calvary's hill for my sins. The Bible says, you shall be saved. Once you are saved, then you're going through a process called sanctification. And that's the process we go through for the entirety of our time here on earth. That is when we are set apart to do service, where we come and join a local body, where we begin to do the work of ministry, that one day when we die, we can stand before him and receive our glorification, where we're able to put on perfection and dwell with him forever. And every day will be holy, holy, holy. Every day we will worship him. It is there that you can accept your salvation today and then move to your sanctification and one day your glorification. We pray today that you accept Jesus before it's everlasting too late. Amen, amen. If you would, prepare your hearts and minds to give unto the Lord.
Worship through giving. Luke 6:38 says, "Give, and it shall be given unto you, a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured unto you." Text KGMBC to 77977 or KGMBC APP to 77977. To give through our website, log on to www.cashmeregardensmbc.org. To pay through Zelle, the payee is kgmbcfinance@gmail.com. To pay through Cash App, hashtag Cashmere Gardens MBC. If you would like to send a love offering to our pastor, hashtag Pastor ELD. Our mailing address is 4302 Cavalcade Street, Houston, Texas, 77026. Stay connected.
Thank you for your tithes, your offering, and your gifts. We pray God blesses you some 30, some 60, some 100-fold. At this time, we ask that you now prepare your hearts, your minds, and your elements to partake in the communion meal. Please do so at this time. I pray that all of you have had a chance to gather your elements for the communion. At this time, we'll have a prayer over the bread and over the cup. Let us bow. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the bread that symbolizes your body, which was broken for us. Thank you, God, for going to Calvary's cross and enduring the punishment on your body, that we know that by your stripes we are healed. And then, God, we thank you for the cup that represents your blood of the New Testament covenant. That, Heavenly Father, that as we drink, God, let us remember your death until you come again. In Jesus' name, amen. On the same night in which our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ was betrayed, he took bread, and when he broke it, he gave thanks and said, "Eat, this is my body. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same manner, he took the cup and said, "This is my blood of the New Testament. Drink ye all of it." For as often as you eat of the bread and drink of the cup, you do show forth the Lord's death till he come again. And we all agreed by saying, Amen. Amen, church. We pray that as you have been a partaker of the communion meal, we pray that you remember the Lord's death until he comes again. We would like to thank all of you for your participation in our Resurrection Sunday on today, as well as our communion service. We pray the Lord continues to bless and keep each and every one of you. We want to give special thanks to Dr. Ernest Pugh for coming out today and sharing with us in gospel song. We pray that God continues to bless him and his ministry in the days to come. Also, Cashmere Garden, we have a special treat for our children at 12 o'clock, from 12 to 2 o'clock. We'll have an Easter egg hunt. We're asking that you bring your children. Please wear your face mask and allow them to come out and search for eggs. We pray for good fun, good fellowship for our children as we come together in love. And then we want to continue to pray you one for another. Thank God for you, Cashmere Garden. As we continue to grow, glow, and go, let us do so with humility of mind and heart, knowing that God himself will see us through. Why don't you look at me while I bless you? Now may the grace of God, the love of Christ, the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, may it rest, may it rule, and abide with us now and forevermore. And we all responded by saying amen. Look, do me a favor. Won't you look around and tell somebody, I love you, and there's nothing you can do about it but love me back. And you know what I always say to you, Cashmere, a better me makes a better us. Enjoy your day. I love you. Go in peace.